I was born in 1946 in Loosedale, Mississippi, and grew up in what I call a dysfunctional family. We didn't realize it at the time. In fact, we didn't know what the word dysfunctional meant. We were dysfunctional when dysfunctional wasn't cool, I guess is a good way to say it. That being said, I did have incredible grandparents, and they were my role models in life, and especially my grandfather. He was my idol, and I watched every move that he made and everything that he did and attempted to pattern my life after him. When I graduated from high school at 18 years old, I left Loosedale and moved to the Mississippi Gulf Coast. And I've been here ever since, and live now in Van Cleve. As a child growing up, I was an introvert. Didn't think much of myself, probably because of the home that I'd grown up in. And of course, started running around with the wrong crowd and got involved in some things in high school that I shouldn't have been involved in. Had a moral compass as a result of having great grandparents, but at the same time chose to attempt to fit in with my peers and go out and drink and carouse and things with them. But that eventually ran its course by the time I was 22, 23 years old. I think when I was 24 years old, I met a young lady that I was very attracted to, and after a short whirlwind romance, we decided to be married and enjoyed our early younger years as a married couple. Eventually had an incredible young lady who's my daughter, and shortly after that we began to drift apart, and we had some issues in our marriage that could not be overcome, and we divorced after 17 years. My wife was in the hospital delivering our daughter. She had some complications, and as a result, I actually brought the baby home several days before she was able to come home. And I think it was at that time that my daughter and I bonded. And from that time on, we just had an incredible relationship as a father and daughter. I taught her how to fish, how to ride her bike, and attempted to teach her to roller skate. We spent an awful lot of time together, and through that time we built a relationship that continues even to today. Through today, she's the apple of my eye, always has been and always will be. After I was divorced, I never gave any thought to remaining single. I just assumed that I would find someone relatively soon and probably remarry and start all over again with a new wife. And although I went through several relationships, had several relationships after my divorce, none of those was what I was looking for. And after about 3 years, I became acclimated to the life of a single person, in that I learned to be alone without being lonely. And I think that's probably a problem that most people have a tendency to have, is they don't stay alone long enough to master being alone without being lonely. It's been an incredible asset in my life. When I graduated from high school, I moved to Pascagoula and to go to work with a phone company, and then eventually meandered over to Ocean Springs, where I lived there with my wife. And after we were divorced, I moved back to Loosedale for a year, and ultimately moved again back to the Mississippi Gulf Coast, settling in Van Cleve. Van Cleve is a unique community. It's the closest thing probably that we have today to Mayberry. And because of that, I can't imagine anyone not wanting to live here. In 1971, after I started my construction business, we began building homes in a very difficult time anyway. Then things got progressively worse after the election and Jimmy Carter was elected president. The interest rates began to climb on mortgage loans, and before long they were in the 18% to 22% range on mortgage loans, and as a result I had an awful lot of homes at various stages of construction and could not sell them. So I began to negotiate my way out of that, eventually closed that company down without filing bankruptcy. It was through that time in my life that I became a Christian. I was 31 years old when that happened. I'd been in business, as I said, since 1971, probably about 8-9 years, something like that. And when I had no place else to turn, no place else to go, it was then that I went to my face, went to my knees, and gave my heart and my life to Jesus Christ. How I became a Christian was interesting. I was working late one night, had another job, a second job, in addition to still being a contractor, and my supervisor asked me that night if I was a Christian. Seems that his church had been in revival and he was very excited about it. And my answer was no, and he asked me why, and I gave him a reason which made absolutely no sense to anyone but me. And he said, "Wayne, that's not it. That's not the way it works." And he said, "I can't explain it, but here." And he reached in his coat pocket and he handed me a little Bible tract, which had nothing to do with my reason for not becoming a Christian, but I took it. Later on that night, when after I went to bed, I couldn't sleep. I tossed and I turned, and I was married then. My wife was sound asleep, but I got up and went into the living room. I was going to sit in there, maybe turn the television on for a while, but when I walked in to the living room, I looked on the coffee table, and there was this Bible tract that I'd taken out of my pocket when I got home. And I picked it up and I started reading it. And it was actually the Romans Road. It was telling me how I could become a Christian, telling me, first of all, that I needed to. All have sinned, come short of the glory of God. And after I read that, and immediately, it's almost like God empowered that little piece of paper, that little Bible tract, and it became alive. And that was God to me at that particular moment. I went on my knees and on my face on the floor, and I cried out to God and surrendered my heart and my life to Him. And my journey's been totally different ever since. Shortly after I got saved and was born again, I started attending church, a small church close by. And through that church, I was challenged by the men there to take on responsibilities and ultimately to begin teaching Bible study classes and doing various things that way. A little later, I began to think about my life and determined that I needed to write down some of the events in my life. And before I knew it, I was writing a book. And it ultimately was published, and it was a story of my life, beginning in my childhood and all the way through to that particular place where I was writing the book. And once that book was written, then it opened all kinds of doors for me to go and to speak and to begin to teach. I began teaching in various places, and eventually, again, because having had written a book, I was asked by various people to travel and to speak in retreats and conferences and that kind of thing. Mississippi Baptist Convention Board began to use me in conferences all over the state. I was used by Lifeway and at Ridgecrest for single adult conferences, primarily up there for 7 or 8 years, and had an opportunity to go and teach in the Young Adult World Conference in Hong Kong 1 year, which was an incredible experience with 7,000 young people showing up of all different nationalities. And I guess God began opening one door after another, which eventually would lead me to teach and become a part of the ministry at the Home of Grace. I remember one morning I was praying in my bedroom, and after struggling in my business for many, many years, and I had been a Christian at that time probably 7-8 years, maybe more, and I just cried out to God and told Him that I was tired of working so hard and getting nowhere. And almost immediately, God impressed upon me one verse of scripture, and it was Matthew 6:33, which says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these things will be added unto you." And that was God's way of saying, this is why you have not been successful. This is why nothing works for you. This is why you struggle. And so in a millisecond, I just kind of said, okay, I'll try you on that. And I did. I started putting the things of God first in my life, and He literally opened the windows of heaven and started showering out blessings on me. And within 5 years, I was able to retire and get involved in ministry full-time, ministering at the Home of Grace, ministering, traveling through speaking and teaching, ministering through writing books. So God kept His end of the bargain. Do you think for one minute that I'd ever want to go back? And I'd ever want to give up on that? The answer, of course, is no. In mid-2011, Billy Barton came into my office. Billy is Bill Barton's son. Bill Barton, of course, founded the Home of Grace in 1965. Billy walked in my office one day and sat down, and he asked if I would be interested in working with him on a new project, and that project was going to be writing his dad's life story. I thought about it for a little while, and of course I told him yes, and he already had a name picked out for the book. The name was going to be A Man, a Mountain, and God. And so we began, and I did extensive research going back really into Bill Barton's childhood from the time he was born, and putting together everything that I could find that would define who he was. As a result of doing that, I became to know him probably as well as anybody, in that I know things about him that not many people know because of the research that I did. That has been an incredible asset to my life, in that I discovered during that time what it takes to be a true man of God. I think it was around October of 2011, a friend of mine called me one day, and he had gotten an email, a forward, from someone indicating that our country was going through some difficulties, and which is, of course, was no surprise to any of us, but the email suggested that the men in this country get out, the Christian men get out in their workshops or garages and build up a little cross, paint it white, put it in their front yard to make a statement that, yes, we are a Christian nation. He suggested, what we would do is he and I would build up some of these crosses and signs and put them up for sale and donate the money to the ministries of Home of Grace. Well, of course, that piqued my interest, and I told him I'd think about it, and I was getting ready to take a trip, and I told him I'd call him in 4 or 5 days when I came back. And while I was gone, that was pretty much all I thought about. When I returned, I returned with the idea of adding a sign to the cross, and the cross would stand alone, a little white cross with a sign planted beside it with 2 Chronicles 7:14 written on it, which says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven and I'll forgive their sin and I'll heal their land." That's the formula for revival, and that's the formula for reconciliation to God. And we have the formula. We just have to choose to do it. We spent several months after that formulating and organizing the ministries of Our Great Awakening. Our Great Awakening is a unique ministry in that it began as a fundraiser for the Home of Grace, but it's since taken on a life of its own. The vision there is one of hundreds of thousands of crosses and signs and yards of Christians all across our land, and that would accomplish an awful lot of things. First of all, it would bring passive Christians who may be not that involved in ministry, it would bring them to a point of decision to where they could identify their particular passion for whatever ministry they might want to get involved in. But that placing the cross and sign in their front yard, it could really just be the first step toward that. And it also makes us accountable. If we have a cross and a sign in our front yard, and on the sign is 2 Chronicles 7:14, then it reminds us every day, at least twice a day, when we leave for work or when we come home from work, that we need to be living that out. We need to be active, involved Christians rather than passive, inactive Christians. And so that's another thing that can happen. The other incredible positive about our Great Awakening is the excitement that permeates a church when we have an awakening event at a church on any given Sunday. The congregation, they're very excited about taking their cross and their sign home and plant it in the front yard. And as we've discovered, many of these crosses and signs have remained up almost 2 years now and haven't been taken down, which was a real surprise, a pleasant surprise to us that the crosses and signs are staying up. So we're excited about the ministry. We're dedicated to what we do, and we continue to move toward covering this nation with crosses and signs to give our country hope again.